So first I'm going to describe the show. Maybe you can get a better idea of whether or not it's something you're going to be interested in, because it's definitely not for everybody. And then later I'm going to delve into more analysis of what actually happens in specific episodes. So easy is mumblecore, and I'm going to explain exactly what that means. A lot of times people use this term and they use it incorrectly. You're not using it incorrectly if you call this mumblecore. This is mumblecore, I won't say at its finest, but this is mumblecore at its most pure. So with mumblecore, the director takes characters that aren't rich, aren't poor, or in that middle range, aren't too young, aren't too old, usually late 20s, early 30s, creates some kind of theme or something going on in their lives, but then just lets them have free rein, just lets them talk. There's really no set script. It's all improvisational, they say. So the director really tries to let them talk, and what he's going for is naturalism. He really wants it to feel like this isn't a TV show, this isn't a movie. You're just a fly on the wall watching what real life is for these characters who are in their late 20s and are maybe going through these common things that we all go through, jealousy, infidelity, stuff like that. And it's not character-driven in the sense that it tries not to show you larger-than-life characters that, oh, they're off the wall and they're so funny, and God, I can't wait to tune in next week because I love this character so much. No, it tries to show you people and how they are in real life. And oftentimes, mumblecore shifts back and forth between optimism, maybe one moment, and then pessimism the next, and doesn't really take a stand either way. And rather than trying to take these themes and provide some answers and say things about them, it really just tries to show these themes and have you maybe draw your own answer or realize that there is no answer, and that's an answer in and of itself. And the title of Easy, it can be seen as a joke that the questions and the things that the show tries to tackle, the answers are anything but easy, and the experience of watching the show, again, it's anything but easy. It's not an easy show to watch. Sometimes you've got to kind of stick with it. And I will say, this is one of the few TV shows that really is kind of an undiscovered gem. There's a lot of, you know, cult classics or cult shows that have huge numbers of articles written about them, huge followings. If you Google Easy, there's very few articles written about it, very, very few YouTube videos. I think this is going to be one of the only videos. So it really is an indie show. And one more thing to give you an idea of what the show is going for. The show tries to make the characters who we see in these different episodes show how they're loosely connected in a realistic way. So in one season, in the first season, there's a character and she's going off to LA to be an actress. And then in the next season, Aubrey Plaza is watching TV and you see that character on TV on her show. And that's it. That's the connection. So rather than the show being like, oh, everyone's connected and all these crazy coincidences and suddenly everyone's intertwined, no, it tries to show how, yeah, people are connected, but it's oftentimes in these very passing, loose ways. So now we'll get more into analysis. One theme that you could say Easy tries to explore is not a theme at all. It's just showing modern life, and I thought it does it great. There's this one episode where you have two characters. You have one who's a person who's a comedian, and he also drives Uber, and he uses the stories he has or the talks he has with people in his Uber car. He tries to use that for his comedy. And then you have another character. She's a prostitute, a classy prostitute, but a prostitute nonetheless, and she has these talks with her clients, and she tries to use them for her blog. And it's just a great realistic portrayal of new up-and-coming young people and what different people are doing that they haven't done in the past. And if you say, oh, a prostitute blogging about her clients, that's so unrealistic. The actress, if you look her up, her real life isn't all that different from what they portrayed. I don't think she's actually a prostitute, but she has a sex column and she often writes about her life and her sexual experiences. But I think it's a cop-out to say Easy just shows and depicts and doesn't actually try to say anything. So what do I think it's trying to say? One theme that runs through a lot of episodes is that oftentimes what we rationally believe and the politics that we hold can run in conflict to our instincts and our most primal desires. And this starts right from episode one, where you have this very liberal, progressive couple, but it shows that, especially in the bedroom, they can't kick some of these conservative impulses. And then they show it's not just middle-aged straight couples. In season two, you have someone who's queer and she's a feminist and having feminist art shows and she's so proud of her sex positivity. But then as soon as her girlfriend actually starts stripping in a burlesque show, suddenly these things that she was just talking about and were very abstract and she could completely agree with, as soon as it becomes concrete and real to her, all these things that she maybe had no idea were contained in her, suddenly these things kick in and this primal jealousy and possessiveness. And it shows that sometimes even the most bohemian of us can't free ourselves from these bourgeois neuroses. And then another storyline we get, Dave Franco is a great depiction of what I think an increasing number of men, especially young men, are like, where he has his passion. He loves making beer. He loves making the kind of beer he wants to make with his friends and spending time with his girlfriend or his loved ones. And I think that's what an increasing amount of men are like, where he has no ambition to have a 9-to-5 job, to get a big important title, to buy this big house and fill it with a bunch of stuff. He's happy with his life and how it is, and he's happy with his passions, and he's happy with his loved ones. And then what happens is, as soon as his girlfriend gets pregnant, immediately you see how he takes the first step into a life that he never wanted. He starts going down this corporate road, and he starts opening this bigger brewery with his brother. And then all the reviewers who watch this say, oh, it's insufferable watching Dave Franco's tantrums, where his brother will explain just the basic facts of life to him. Of course you get a 9-to-5 job that you hate, and of course you spend your life following these rules that you don't agree with and making crap that you don't really care about but is profitable. Everybody does that. Men have been doing that for all of time, and now all women are doing that as well, and you have both couples working a 9-to-5 job they hate and then paying money for a babysitter to raise their kids. Like, of course, just man up and just stop being a baby. That's just life. But the series doesn't do that. Most shows, they would just show Dave Franco, oh, he gradually accepts his 9-to-5 job and realizes that the security and stability, well, that's what the meaning of life really is. But the movie doesn't, or sorry, the TV show doesn't do that. What it does, Dave Franco, at one point, he's like, well, we agreed that one of us was going to raise our child and we weren't going to have a babysitter. And then his girlfriend says, well, yeah, but that someone's going to be me. It's always going to be me. So don't BS a BSer. But then Dave Franco, at the end of the story arc, he says, no, I will stay home with our child. I'm perfectly willing to do that. And I'll keep making my beer at a low level. And I'll support you. And if you want to go out and have that corporate dream, you do that. And I'm happy with that life. And it's so interesting because, one, I see more and more men considering this as an option. I think one of the biggest myths that's come out of the past is that staying home with the kids and raising them is a horrible thing, or it's an unpleasant experience. Now, just because it was in certain instances and women were forced to do that, that doesn't mean that it's inherently unpleasant. And you could say, yeah, it's not always easy, but is it worse than working and commuting to a 9-to-5 job every day that you hate? Of course not. It's probably way better than that, especially nowadays when you have the internet and you have so many hobbies and video games and so many things to fill your time when you're at home. There's never been a better time to stay at home and cook and clean and raise the kids and then also follow your passion. So I think you'll see more and more people doing that. But, and this goes back to easy, always being ambiguous and always, you know, alternating between points of view. We already saw in episode one an example of a couple who the husband followed his dream of acting and she went into the corporate world, and then suddenly the attraction isn't there anymore. And then there's a study that says women are more attracted to men who are the breadwinner and don't help out around the house. So again, it just shows that, yeah, maybe this is something that more and more men are wanting to do, but there's also maybe going to be some downsides to that as well and some things that we have to iron out. And then we get this really interesting theme that oftentimes the most avant-garde of artists, the people who are most experimental and pushing the boundaries, at a certain point, they stop being avant-garde, and whoever comes up and is the next avant-garde and pushes the boundaries even further, those artists who originally pushed the boundaries, they're the most resistant and the most appalled at this new people claiming to be artists, but they're not really artists. Like, what I do is art, and when I push the boundaries, that was experimental and groundbreaking. What they do, it's a travesty, and they use all the same insults that were probably used against them against this new art. And you see this with Marc Maron, the cartoonist, when he meets this new selfie artist, but you also see it with that lesbian couple I talked about earlier, where she has the feminist art show, and then her girlfriend starts doing the burlesque, where again, she thinks she's avant-garde and experimental, and she's very proud of being an artist. And then suddenly someone pushes things further and says, well, actually, my burlesque show, that's art too. And suddenly she gets defensive and says, well, no, I'm an artist. You can't just claim to be an artist doing whatever you want. And suddenly she, who was the most experimental, suddenly she's the conservative. And then there's this episode where the parents, they're very well off, and they want their daughter, who's about to go to college, they want her to be more involved in religion, spirituality, the community. So they say, you got to go to church. The daughter, kind of almost out of spite, listens to all the stuff they say at church about how it's easier for a rich person to get to heaven, or it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle, which is impossible, than a rich person to go to heaven. Or at least that's one interpretation. So she sees it as hypocritical that her parents, with all this wealth and all this material possessions, they're pushing her to go to church, but then they wouldn't really want her to actually follow any of the stuff she learns there. So out of spite, she begins to do this charity work, and then you see what started as kind of to spite her parents develops to her actually saying, oh, I'm going to be charitable and I'm going to spend my life giving and helping other people. Then it shows her that her gift, she gives her entire college fund, $50,000, to the church, and she sees they blow it on an altar. So she experienced kind of what all people who get involved in charity, which is their best intentions, and they give and they give and they give, and then they see all this gift squandered and not actually helping people. And then at that point, what do? Do you just give up on charity and be selfish? Or do you keep giving nonetheless, knowing that a lot of the times it is squandered? Okay, I'm going to end it there. There's so many more things I could talk about, so many more performances that were just incredible and I want to give a shout out to, but there's just too much to talk about. I'm going to end the video there, but I'll probably make more videos. It is a great show, and it's just, it's a shame that more people don't watch the show